أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Today our topic of discussion out of pediatric nephrology is one of the most common problem which we come across in pediatric OPD in reference to the disease of kidney. We will touch upon a time with proteinuria, and then our main focus will be related to different aspects related to nephrotic syndrome. We will initiate our discussion with the case scenario of a 2-year-old boy who admitted with this appearance. Parents were much concerned about the rapid onset of generalized edema in their baby. He was perfectly fine 2 days back when the early morning when he gets up, parents noticed puffiness of his face, and within next 48 hours it extend to almost whole of the body. He was otherwise playful and no complaint of any irritability, fever, or any issues related to respiratory problem. So what will be your clinical judgment about these patients? What is the likely differential diagnosis? When a young boy present with generalized edema, we can call it an anasarca when we are able to demonstrate edema at more than 2 to 3 sites. Though his presentation was with puffiness of face, but when we extended our examination, he did had sacral edema, he did had marked ascites, as well as his scrotum sac was hanging down because of accumulation of fluid in the scrotal sac. Ankle were also very puffy, and one can easily demonstrate pitting edema on the both sides of his feet. But let me share with you a few definitions related to syndrome. We every day come across in pediatric patients syndromes with different names. So practically, syndrome means when a patient is having signs and symptoms at more than 2 sites, and we are able to demonstrate these complaints in few patients over a specified time, that such constellation of symptoms and signs reoccur in certain children, and there is a clinical correlation between these symptoms and signs, then we label them these patients as syndrome. Already you are familiar with trisomy 21 or Down syndrome or monosomy in reference to Turner syndrome or Dijord syndrome or Edwards syndrome. So many other syndromes every day we come in clinical practice. So today our main focus is a syndrome which has its manifestations in the form of edema, in the form of hypoproteinemia, in the form of hypercholesterolemia, as well as in the form of proteinuria. So we call it as nephrotic syndrome. Practically, proteinuria result from some problem with the filtration at the level of glomeruli when there is abnormal charge at the endothelial surface, or there is loss of food processes or what we call as podocytes at the glomerular endothelium. So that leads to leakage of significant of protein, which is not able to be reabsorbed at the proximal convoluted tubule. Generally, low molecular weight protein do cross at the glomerular epithelium and endothelium, but they are perfectly reabsorbed at proximal convoluted tubule. This is called physiological proteinuria, where a small amount of low molecular weight protein are excreted into the urine. Many of the children, they have transient proteinuria, otherwise don't have any complaints in reference to edema, in reference to hypertension, but just at a routine examination, one is able to find a significant amount of proteinuria, but without any other constellation of symptoms. Many of these children, they have proteinuria because when they move about, there is a significant amount of protein is leaked from the glomeruli. But when they lie down, and especially in the early morning, one notices that there is no proteinuria. So that is called orthostatic proteinuria, or proteinuria in an upright posture. But there are conditions like nephrotic syndrome, in which whatever the situation may be, whatever the position of the patient may be, there is persistent leakage of protein, or what we call as fixed proteinuria. There are different methods for determination of proteinuria. With the help of sulfolyl salicylic acid, one can able to demonstrate protein in the urine by dipstick method, but there are other methodology applied in which one can demonstrate if urine is collected for 24-hour urinary protein, then when the quantum of protein is so high that it is more than 2 gram per meter square per 24 hours, so we call this as nephrotic range proteinuria. When one is not able to collect urine for such a long period, then in a simple spot sample, we are able to find the ratio of protein and urinary protein and urinary creatinine. And if it is more than 0.2, that is abnormal protein to creatinine ratio. But for nephrotic protein, nephrotic range proteinuria, this ratio of spot protein to creatinine in a single specimen of urine should be more than 2. So nephrotic syndrome or nephrosis is characterized by proteinuria, hypoproteinemia, generalized edema, as well as hypercholesterolemia or hyperlipidemia. Just to reiterate, to make it clear, that proteinuria in nephrotic syndrome is massive proteinuria, that is more than 2 gram per meter square per 24 hours. So then, and then we only call it as nephrotic syndrome. One can demonstrate, one can establish different causes leading to nephrotic syndrome, but practically we subdivide into primary and secondary causes. Primary nephrotic syndrome, when the problem is only inside the renal parenchyma. Minimum change disease is the most common cause of nephrotic syndrome, while focal segmental glomerular sclerosis and meningeal proliferation are other relatively uncommon, but we do come across in patient if they are older than 8 years of age. Secondary causes are primarily different type of glomerulonephritis in the form of membranous, membranoproliferative. One can also see in patient with the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma secondary to hepatitis B and C, or in reference to quartan malaria. So these are the different causes which leads to secondary type of nephrotic syndrome. Practically idiopathic nephrotic syndrome mean, or minimal change disease mean, that by simple light microscopy we are not able to demonstrate any pathology. Only with the use of electron microscopy one is able to demonstrate loss of food processes or problem with the char at the endothelial level. So that's the reason they are called as minimal change nephrotic syndrome. Patient of focal sclerosis and mesangial proliferation, they do respond to steroid therapy. Just to mention that minimal chain disease is also characterized by a remarkable rapid response to steroid therapy. While in patients with focal sclerosis or mesangial proliferation, they do have response to corticosteroid, but they take longer and even they are notorious for recurrence or relapse of the disease. Why are more commonly affected? For minimal change nephrotic syndrome, the good age or peak age is 2 to 6 years. In addition to proteinuria and generalized edema, they sometimes also have a complaint of weight gain because of pleural effusion ascites. There are problem with tachypnea, and some parents also complains of decreased urine output. Some patient also has problem with the appetite, pain abdomen secondary to peritonitis, but the most common and most characteristic manifestation of nephrotic syndrome is the puffiness of face, especially when patient gets up early in the morning, like in this patient. So for this boy, we went for urine examination, and on urine examination, we found that he was having 3 to 4 plus proteinuria, what we called as gross proteinuria. We went for 24-hour urinary protein, and it depicted that there was 2 gram loss of protein in a day. Hypoalbuminemia was marked, and characteristically, their complement 3 level was normal. So before moving forward, let's focus on the MCQs that will give you a sigh of relaxation and also update your knowledge. So which of the following practically is not a feature of minimal change disease? You have 5 options. When you are post your attendance, so also suggest what is out of these 5, what is the best option for minimal change disease. So differential diagnosis in this patient is nephrotic syndrome. But we, in a patient who presents with generalized edema, one should also consider subtype of nephrotic syndrome, post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis, congestive cardiac failure, if there are symptoms related to tachypnea, dyspnea, or problem with the liver. A malnourished child can also have generalized edema, while patient with protein losing enteropathy, they also manifest with generalized edema. In nephrotic syndrome, as I mentioned, one can come across different type of complications, and out of these, the most common is different type of infection. Peritonitis is the most common complication we come across, but sepsis, pneumonia, cellulitis around the scrotum or over the abdominal wall because of massive ascites, recurrent urinary tract infection, they are also common infections we come across in these patients. These patients of nephrotic syndrome are also liable to develop venous thrombosis or deep vein thrombosis because of the loss of antithrombin 3 or problem with the platelet aggregation. One also, in addition to albumin, also lose significant coagulation proteins in the urine. So treatment options for nephrotic syndrome is prednisolone in the form of oral tablets. We start with 60 milligram per meter square and keep on repeating urine for protein at intervals of few days. Most of these patients, they have urine free of protein or resolving his problem of albuminuria in 5 to 7 days. With the initiation of steroid therapy, there is a disappearance of albumin from the urine, as well as building up of a serum albumin level, and their urine become free of protein. When protein is free for 5 days, then we switch on to we continue with this dose for a couple of weeks, but we decrease the dose from 60 milligram to 40 milligram per meter square, for continue this therapy for 3 to 6 months. Such a prolonged steroid therapy generally is very helpful for the prevention of relapses in these patients. Some of these patients, they don't go into protein-free state, and even after 1 month of continuous steroid therapy, we don't have disappearance of proteinuria. So then these patients are labeled as steroid. If after a month of therapy, patient is not free of proteinuria, so then we label it as steroid resistant. There are small number of patients in which urine is free of protein, but once we switch on to decreased dose of steroid or discontinuation of steroid therapy, within a week of discontinuation of therapy, one can again has proteinuria or appearance of symptoms. So these patients, they are termed as steroid sensitive, but they are practically taken as steroid dependent nephrotic syndromes. We call these as frequent relapser because I mentioned these patients, they have the ability to relapse, and if there are more than 3 episodes of proteinuria over a 1 year period, so they are taken as frequent relapser. While continuing with steroid therapy, one, because of prolonged use of prednisolone, very commonly we come across complications like Cushingoid appearance, like hypertension, and even growth failure. Because of steroid therapy, there is liable to develop infections, and there is because of immunosuppressive, one can come across different type of infective complications. If patient is not responding to oral form of prednisolone therapy, one can switch on to injectable steroid therapy in the form of methyl prednisolone for 5 to 7 days. Some of these patients, they do respond to immunosuppressive therapy like cyclophosphamide or azathioprine. Generally, nephrotic syndrome has good prognosis. Most of these patients, especially minimal change nephrotic syndrome, at the end of first decade, they completely get rid of their problem. So most of the patients don't have these symptoms in their second decade of life. So let's move on to another MCQs of a 5-year-old boy who is a known patient of nephrotic syndrome. Out of these 5 options, what will be your treatment, or what will be your first choice of therapy? So put it, this response on your attendance marking procedure. This is another interesting scenario of a 6-year-old girl, and you have to answer this short essay question and answer three questions after this scenario. So this 6-year-old was girl has developed irritability, headache, and vomiting. Parents are very concerned because she has been passing significantly less amount of urine. On examination, she do have puffiness of eyes, edema especially over the ankles, and there is hypertension as 130 by 90 millimeter of mercury. At the angle of 45, one is able to have a high, able to demonstrate raised JVP, and urine examination of this young girl reveals both proteinuria as well as hematuria, and on light microscopy, one can see a field full of red blood cells. So, what is the most likely diagnosis? What suggestory investigation you will ask in this girl, and what will be your first four steps of management? So with this, thank you very much for joining, for listening. One of the most common problem, nephrotic syndrome in pediatric nephrology. So answer these MCQs and SCQs, and that will also help you improve your knowledge, your discussion related to nephrotic syndrome as well as nephritis. So thank you very much for patient listening.